today we have the perfect person to give us advice. We have with us Dr. Apurba Mukherjee. He is the HOD of Medicine and Endocrinology at RG Corps Medical College from Calcutta. It's so good to have you here with us, sir. And welcome to this talk on Macleods Medlive at APCON 2019. So I think we can start with the problem that India is facing today. India is the epicenter of diabetes. So let's start talking about what, according to you, is the importance of diagnosing HbA1c along with PPG, FPG.
It's very important that many of our patients are to be diagnosed not only by the fasting plasma glucose and not only by the postprandial plasma glucose, but to view in a greater perspective to analyze the HbA1c right at the time of diagnosis, because we spells heavily about the presence of hyperglycemia for a longer period of time, and it is important that if the HbA1c is more, that spells that the hyperglycemia is pretty longer and pretty high. So it is important that we do test not only the fasting plasma glucose, postprandial plasma glucose. If it is compounded with the estimation of the glycated hemoglobin, that spells heavily about the degree as well as the duration of hyperglycemia. If we test the fasting plasma glucose, that's a momentary reading. If we test the postprandial plasma glucose, that's also a momentary reading for that particular day at that particular point of time after 2 hours of the calorie intake, that is the usual lunch. But when it is compounded with the glycated hemoglobin estimation, we learn about the degree of hyperglycemia and the prevailing duration, as because HbA1c spells about the presence of hyperglycemia and its degree for the past 8 to 12 weeks of time. So it is also very important. Thereby, we can plan our treatment, we can educate our patient and make them aware about the condition prevailing in him or her for this duration of time and in this magnitude.
And doctor, also do let us know, what is the regularity of a patient doing the checkups?
That's very important, that we have to ask our patient to do checkups, particularly when they are not achieving control in a frequent manner, as opposed to people who are quite adherent to their treatment and the previous estimations are quite acceptable, there are some amount of leniency or complacency may be allowed. As for example, if a person has got a fasting blood sugar of 300 mg per deciliter 1 month or 1.5 month earlier, it is prudent to check it early so that the patient gets into the area of achieving control much more avidly, because the estimation blood sugar and the estimated values tells a lot about his inner self, so that he becomes more motivated, and thereby a frequent testing is advocated while the blood sugar control is not that acceptable. But people who are having a long duration of diabetes, quite adherent and compliant with their therapy and the lifestyle modification, they can enjoy some amount of leniency and complacency, because the previous estimation was acceptable and the previous one is also acceptable. Now he can enjoy some amount of complacency, checking it beyond 6 weeks, beyond 8 weeks of time.
Alright doctor, we would also like to know, what is your ideal choice of drug for a patient who has just been diagnosed with diabetes?
Person who is diagnosed to have diabetes and the degree of hyperglycemia is not that huge, it is important that the HbA1c should be checked. If the HbA1c is less than 7.5%, as we all know that the normal HbA1c is less than 5.7%, if it is less than 7.5% or even 8%, we can embark upon only lifestyle modification plus metformin, as it is advocated by so many authoritative bodies. But if our country do have a huge number or huge proportion of patients whose diabetes is diagnosed while the hyperglycemic load is very, very high, if the HbA1c is 8.5% or more than 7.5%, less than 9%, it is prudent to start with a dual therapy. So far as dual therapy is concerned, we are comfortable in majority of situations using a metformin along with the DPP-4 inhibitor, and sometimes a metformin with a pioglitazone, and sometimes we do have to deal with other agents like alpha-glucosidase inhibitors, because they addresses the carbohydrate intake, which is quite high in this population. But while the HbA1c is more than 9%, it is either triple therapy or sometimes exogenous insulin, which is to be initiated early, because quick achievement of good glycemia is the goal.
Okay, so your suggestion of an ideal drug for a patient with a comorbid condition would be?
For comorbid condition, it is important to visualize whether your patient has got already established cardiovascular disease. Already atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease spells heavily about the usage of liraglutide, which is drug has shown the benefit in presence of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, or a SGLT2 inhibitor drug. Either of these two can be combined with metformin, because the different authoritative bodies have seen the cardiovascular benefit outcome with these two particular agents in the presence of comorbid conditions. It is also important to realize that some people might have renal insufficiency, and when there is mild to moderate renal insufficiency, it is important to estimate the estimated GFR, and metformin has to be decided. When the GFR is less than 45, we can give a more mild dose of metformin, but not a very high dose. When it is less than 30, we should not embark on metformin therapy altogether. It is also important to avoid SGLT2 inhibitor class of drugs when the estimated GFR is less than 45. And in majority of situations, a DPP-4 inhibitor with metformin may be welcome, but comorbid conditions, particularly cardiovascular disease and renal functional insufficiency, spells about the avoidance of different classes of drugs on an individualistic basis.
And for a patient with uncontrolled glycemic levels, the ideal drug would be again?
If an ideal drug in a patient who is thoroughly engaged on lifestyle modification, the duration of diabetes is quite prolonged, and he is using 3 drugs or 4 drugs in the oral route, if still not achieving control, it is useful to switch over to insulin, because insulin is the agent which can reduce the glycemia to any extent. And with the advent of the designer insulins, particularly the basal insulin in type 2 diabetics, might be considered to be the first insulin usage. And sometimes it has to be combined with the one shot of rapid acting insulin, which is called the basal plus recommendation, or sometimes the basal along with 2-3 rapid acting insulin, which is called the basal bolus therapy.
All right, doctor, that was absolutely engaging and informative. Thank you so much for joining and sharing so much with us. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.